नमस्ते, होप ऑल आर हैप्पी। द कोरोना कोविड 19 सिचुएशन इज वेरी ड्रास्टिकली इम्प्रूव्ड विद वैक्सीनेशन बीइंग गिवन टू मोर एंड मोर पीपल। द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया, द हेड ऑफ द गवर्नमेंट टेकिंग फुल रेस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी फॉर द वैक्सीनेशन। द कॉन्फिडेंस हैज इंक्रीज अमंग द पीपल एंड very recently on the first day of 21st June 2021, 82 plus lakh citizens have been inoculated or vaccinated on a single day, which is a very promising note. With this situation, the so-called the third wave may come, may attack us, but the vaccination will stay strong as a defense mechanism. With this confidence, we will march ahead, irrespective of whether vaccinated or not vaccinated. We need to protect ourselves from the coronavirus. Let us exercise those safety measures which are advised. Today we are stepping into step 17 of Kriya Kundalini Awakening. The 29th June 2021 Tuesday. Yesterday we have completed 21 days of step 16. Moving forward to step 17, we are going to discuss very highly spiritual aspect of life given by step 17. In the step 16, we have seen the linga playing a role with the shukra, the clarity, the white, the semen, the possibilities of all possibilities which cannot be ruled out, whether this way or that way. The result oriented approach of the Shukracharya, the result oriented approach of the another sage Vishwamitra, using the intelligence, coming to the risk of the neglected community. Step 17 of Kriya Kundalini Awakening, we will discuss the linga and the number 7. Number 7 belongs to Ketu. Rahu and Ketu are one and the same. Although Rahu and Ketu are one body, subsequently they are separated into two entities. Still in Indian astrology, they are considered as the shadowic planet. Interestingly, Rahu belongs to Paintinasa Gotra, whereas Ketu belongs to Jaimini Gotra. Although they were together, they have been separated through an incident which we are not going to discuss in this step. Only to understand, in step 16, in the previous step, we have seen the left brain and the right brain. Left brain is logic oriented, right brain is kinesthetic, love oriented, empathy, sympathy oriented. Emotional aspects oriented, no logics. But in step 17, it is totally different. It is top and the bottom, not left and the right, but top and the bottom. The head is Rahu, the tail is Ketu. Exactly, they are opposite to each other, 180 degree from each other, but always they move together. When Rahu is in 20 degree of one zodiac sign, exactly opposite sign 20 degree will be Ketu. When Rahu moves 2 degree, Ketu also will move 2 degrees only. They are more powerful. Ketu is regarded as the descendant node of the moon or the dragon's tail. Ketu is a shadowic planet, but shadow can make or mar anything in our life. But in Indian astrology, Rahu or Ketu are termed as a planet only or a graha only. Although there is no specific house for them, still they are considered as the planet or graha, because they wield lot of influence on very, very major planets, the sun and moon. all come under Sun family, but Rahu and Ketu are able to swallow even the Sun, the mightiest of all the planets. Of course, Ketu is only a sensitive planet, but Ketu has got very great impact on human life itself. As I said, Ketu has got tremendous impact on human lives. In some cases, Ketu has helped some people to go to the zenith of the life. We cannot compare the zenith position they have reached, such a zenith position they have reached with the help of Ketu. It is a fact. Those who know astrology can watch for this. Rahu and Ketu both are single body when they took birth to father Viprichiti and mother Singhika. Some places in Singhika is mentioned as the elder sister of Prahalata also. Somewhere it is mentioned she is the cousin sister of Prahalata, that is Hiranyakashipu's sister or daughter, some places, because the same name is reflected in many places. In Sanatana Dharma, we always had the father's or aunt's name or the elder's name in the family is being again used for the children. In this way, Singhika is referred to as the sister of Hiranyakashipu, and in some places it is mentioned as daughter of Hiranyakashipu, who happens to be the cousin sister of Prahlada. Viprachiti, the Rahu Ketu's father, is one of the sons of Kashyap. Kashyapa's sage had 100 children. Among the 100 children, the strongest was Viprachita. There is a bifurcation. Rahu is having the head of a demon, while the body is of a snake. Whereas for Ketu, the body is of human, the head is of snake. As a result of this, their tendency for giving result to the individuals also differ. Rahu works to fulfill the material aspects or material aspirations of the individual on this earth. Whereas Ketu fulfills the spiritual aspirations of the individual on this earth. Rahu plays a lot of mischief to get things done, whereas Ketu will be very straightforward, truthful, obeying by nature. Rahu is fear-oriented, whereas Ketu is opposite of it, confidence or confident-oriented. Always Rahu is dissatisfied, whereas Ketu is satisfied or contented with whatever is available with him. The people who are influenced by number 7 will have all these tendencies. You can watch and understand yourself. While Ketu is unconcerned about the outcome or the life or attachment is concerned, Rahu is too much obsessed with anything. There will be clarity and certainty in Ketu's approach, whereas in Rahu, always there will be a confusion. Everything done in a hurry, everything approached in a haphazard manner, everything is confused, but no clarity can be seen. Unethical politics, unethical occult science application are the product outcome of Rahu, whereas Ketu will not involve in such acts. Ketu always helps, always guides for a spiritual life, for the ultimate. That is the reason Ketu is always referred to as the Mokshakaraka or the ultimate salvation giver in one's life. A person who wants to achieve something spiritually, a person who wants to go to the abode of the Almighty with full certainty of Nirvana, Ketu will definitely help and Ketu will definitely guide. But Only thing in common with both Rahu and Ketu is their opposing sun and moon. All the time, there can be no eclipse on Earth, either lunar eclipse or solar eclipse, in the absence of Rahu. So they are always opposed to sun as well as moon. The power of Rahu is that of almost 1.5 times of sun and moon put together. This being the case, the dreaded is always Rahu. But Ketu always helps for a spiritual outlook, spiritual approach, and always supports one to achieve his salvation. When a person is in 30s, 40s, his or her material aspiration will be more, because till the young blood is there, they can run, they can walk, they can fire, they can swallow anything. As a result, the achieving action will always be in the forefront. As a result of this, they are least bothered about the outcome of anything. Having enjoyed all the material aspects of life, having gone to the last stage of life, if at all one is living for 60, 70 or 80 years, then the person who is reaching always more interested in salvation, more interested in not taking one more birth, more interested in going to moksha, more interested in attaining sarva siddhi samadhi in a very silent manner, not giving trouble to his own body. Although the body does not belong to him, still having lived on this body or in this body, he doesn't want the body to be too much disturbed before he leaves his body and joins the abode of the God. Astrologically, one important point I would like to share. Some of the members may be interested in astrology also. As an extra clipping, I am giving this to you. For many of the individuals, there are so many dashas which will be in operation. One of the prominent dasha will be Ketu dasha. Depending upon the position of the Ketu in our horoscope or Kundali, Ketu dasha will be for 7 years in operation. That 7 year can be divided into 3 parts. 2 year 4 months, 2 year 4 months and 2 year 4 months. Total making 6 years plus 1 year is equal to 12 months. The 3 part of the 7 year will give 3 different results for the person who is undergoing the Ketu Mahadasha. What are those? The first 2 years and 4 months of Ketu Dasha, good results can be definitely achieved by the native. In the second part of 2 years and 4 months, the life could be too much of fearful, fear-oriented living. All the fears descended from Rahu will be transmitted to Ketu Dasha. And the third part, or the end part of the Ketu Dasha, which will operate for 2 years and 4 months, there will be death, or there will be death-like experience for the native. This I am giving just out of context, nothing to do with this KKA or Kriya Kundalini Awakening step 17. Okay, don't stick to this one. This being the step 17, purely oriented towards spiritual. In spirituality, the Bindu is everything. Bindu is supreme. The dot is much more supreme. As a result, we are going to take up the salvation part of the life. What could give a good salvation, a peaceful salvation? What is the way out for salvation? Whether the karma theory will still attack us or still will be attached to us? Whether the Sanchita karma, whether the Prarabdha karma or the Agami karma, will get attached to us still or will attack us, what way, in which way we can escape the karmas, all that we do not know. One can ask us, in what way these karmas can affect us? The Dhyana Bindu Upanishad, one of the very shortest Upanishad. Most of the renderings in this Upanishad have been destroyed. Only few slokas are here and there. Somewhere we can find out. But all the slokas are missing. In Dhyana Bindu Upanishad, a quotation or a quote comes in this way, that if there is a sin like mountain and extending over several leagues or several lineage, that means several generations, if we are all carrying sins, it is destroyed by yoga of dhyana or what we call it as meditation. Never is there any other method of destruction of the sins accumulated by us. This is the straightforward answer given by Dhyana Bindu Upanishad. That means, it says, loads and loads, tons and tons of bad karmas one is carrying on. Then the only way to shed them and go to the abode of the divinity, to the Swarga or to the Nirvikalpa Samadhi or Savikalpa Samadhi or Nirbija Samadhi, whatever name you call, the only way is Dhyana or meditation. Now you would have understood why the Aksharamala Dhyana was suddenly given to me by Mahavatar Babaji, which about 80-90 people got initiated during these few days. Aksharamala Dhyana. There is a saying I have come across, the royal elephant will come behind, but whereas the sound of the bell will come first, the Aruna will come first, the Suryodaya will come little later. Whatever Babaji gives, whatever Mahatar Babaji guides, there is a meaning, there is a very deep-rooted guidance in it. When the Aksharamala Dhyana was given to me to be given to members, very long back it was given, I wanted to call some members and initiate it, at least few members. But each time Mahavatar Babaji was telling, no, hold on, hold on, hold on. Getting words from Mahavatar Babaji, I spent a lot of time on doing research. After doing so much of research, when he said, hold on, I have no right to go further. But I stopped. But suddenly, he just said, study little more with the Thirumular. You will get to know. I was under the impression, if I study, immediately I can burst it out. But it was not. I did research over research, research over research. But the final touch was given by Mahavatar Babaji. And having given everything, he was holding my hand not to go further. It was 3 years, 4 years it happened. But suddenly when 17th step is about to come, the Aksharamala Dhyana initiation was guided. Then it will have much more relation with another Dhyana which is likely to come little later. By that time the Kriya Kundalini series would have been completed. But this Dhyana Bindu Upanishad, having all the text lost, this piece of information with another one or two piece of information is available. It guides us that tons and tons of loads and loads of sins when you are carrying, you need not do anything. The loads and loads of sins which you are carrying from your generations behind, several generations, several leagues, several lineage, the only way to shed them is dhyana or meditation. So that dhyana or meditation which we are going to do. That what it contains, dhyana bindu upanishad, what it is going to guide, what way it is going to give us. Omkara bindu samyuktam nityam dhyayanti yoginaha kamadam mokshadam chaiva omkara namo namaha. What does it mean? What does it elaborately says? Salutation, I offer my salutation to the Supreme, the ultimate Supreme, who resides in the spiritual heart of the sages and ordinary persons, as Omkara, on whom the yogis, the sages, the Pamaras, the ordinary man, every day meditates, by which everything is attained, material or non-material, spiritual or not spiritual, everything is attained through the Omkara. The divinity who grants all the desires of the life in whichever part it is, whether it is a material part, whether it is a spiritual part, whatever it is, to that divinity I offer my salutations. I offer my fullest respect. O Shiva, I want to be with you. Take me to the Bindu and show me the elaborate vision of the Samyukta, the Samyukta, the fullness of the Bindu, which has the Omkara hidden, the highest, the supreme of the supreme, of the supreme master, Shiva. That Omkara, I want to meditate to get the ultimate. That is the meaning of this mantra, which we are going to celebrate by reciting Omkara. This particular Om becomes part of the Sadakshara. Namah Shivaya, five letters with Om added as Samputam become the Sadakshara, mantra of the Supreme Lord, which we are going to enhance ourselves, produce the Omkara, the A-U-M, the Om, sitting comfortably, we are going to recite. Let us enjoy. We will sit, if possible, traditionally, and recite Omkara, that which gives the ultimate to the ultimate, from the ultimate to the ultimate. Because we are not so small. We are also product of the ultimate, and we have to be ultimate. The ultimate is merging with the ultimate. As an ultimate, we do not disconnect from the ultimate. We continue to be with the ultimate. That is the reason some of the members, little in advance, have got the initiation, are initiated into the Aksharamala Dhyana. Maybe the 18th step will have daily one guidance, which will have many mystical things showing to us or rendering, which we come across every day-to-day life. We will continue.
Omkara bindu samyuktam nityam dhyayanti yoginaha कामदं मोक्षदं चैव ओंकाराय नमो नमः।
सल्यूटेशन टू द सुप्रीम हु रिसाइड्स इन द सुप्रीम ओम द AUM consisting of three letters AUM on which the yogins, the supreme masters and the pamras, the ordinary individuals meditate to obtain all the comforts in life, either it is material or it is spiritual, it is physical, it is not physical, it is comfort oriented, happiness oriented, bliss oriented, or spiritually inclined to those yogins, those pamras, the individuals who meditate on Omkara, concentrate on the Bindu, the whole of the universe and its consciousness is residing in the Bindu, the small dot, Samyuktam, all collected, all accumulated or hidden in the form of Om or Omkara within the Bindu. To that sacred Omkara, all meditate. The Sadakshara, Om, being the Samput, being added to the beginning or to the middle or to the end with Namashivaya, the five Aksharas added with Samputa Om, the Supreme, is named or called as Sadakshara. Om Namah Shivaya, the Om on which the yogins or the ordinary persons, the sacred masters, the rishis, their munis, the siddhas, all the learned persons, all the scientists who concentrate on the Bindu in the form of Om. Samyuktam, the Samyuktam is the sum total of everything of the whole, total creation, total universe is hidden in this Omkara. Various religions will say that we do not believe Om. It is pathetic to assume like that. It is like a person claiming that I have come to this world without a mother. In the same way, whichever religion a person belongs, the Om is the beginning, the Om is the end. There cannot be a counter question for this. All those who talk of something different are talking or uttering due to ignorance in their life. Now, we are going to chant this supreme mantra Om 108 times by closing the eyes. All the participants sit in a very comfortable position, sit on a mat on the floor, if not possible, sit on a chair, stool, bench, wherever is comfortable to you. Chin mudra, keep it on the lap on both sides, close your eyes and start chanting Om 108 times.
Oh. Om. 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 Slowly, slowly, slowly rub both your palms. Slightly give a gentle touch to your closed eyes. Give a soothing massage to your nose,
your lips,
your chin, your ears, your forehead. Again, rub the palms. Just open your eyes. See the palm.
See upward.
See downward.
See right side. See left side.
A slight tilt touching the shoulder. Left side. Right side, right side, left side, right side. Rotate. Three times anti-clockwise.
ॐ सद्गुरु बाबा जी नमः। ॐ सद्गुरु बाबा जी नमः। ॐ सद्गुरु बाबा जी नमः।
नमस्ते।